Is Apple's Touch ID a threat to security? Secure SMS for Android. Lavabit is heading to court, and the NSA is sharing data on U.S. persons with Israel. All that and more this time on ThreatWire.
Hello, welcome to ThreatWire. I'm Darren Kitchen.
I'm Shannon Morse.
And this is your summary of what's threatening security, privacy, and internet freedom.
NSA.
I hate you. Anyway.
NSA.
Oh, come on.
And now we have to wait a few minutes, so good time for you to calm it down over there. Now, some security researchers are wary of the new biometric scanners that Apple is toting in their new iPhone generation. While security and convenience are a troubling task for most, Apple's new fingerprint scanner is poised to do away with the necessary passcodes for entry. Now, John Casper, Hamburg Commissioner for Data Protection and Freedom of Information, for example, feels that biometric security scanning is a treasure trove for hackers, giving them access to biometric information stored in a file. Now, that biometric information is a lifelong permanent feature for a person. It's not like a PIN or a passphrase that you could just change all willy-nilly and renew and refresh whenever you want.
I can't change my fingerprints.
No, Darren, you can't. Now, Apple is using a unique sensor to take a fingerprint scan on their iPhone 5S and calling it Touch ID. Stealing a person's print off of a door handle or cutting off someone's fingertip to gain access to their phone won't work, according to Apple. Now, the company has said the biometric scan information will be encrypted and only saved on the device. But Casper feels that information could still be stolen if a device downloads malicious applications. The phone will also not be using two-factor, or so it seems. Apple is planning for Touch ID to take the place of passwords, not add to password security. Also, if the fingerprint is only encrypted and saved on the user's device, what kind of security token is Apple using to authenticate purchases in the App Store, since they are said to be using the fingerprint for that as well? That's a big concern for me. Now, there are many companies that have tried and failed to maintain a fingerprint scanning feature that actually works, with the systems being sluggish or troublesome during use. This actually happened with a lot of laptops in the past. This will most likely not be a concern for iPhones, though. Unless it's another antenna gate, of course.
No, it's the ultimate inconvenience. And I can't wait to see what the fine folks at DEF CON come up with this.
Me too. Now, one concern does stem from the legal side. Will using something you are or something you have, as opposed to something you know, still be safe under the Fifth Amendment if a court is asking for your passcode? Is it the same as a fingerprint? We won't really know for sure how secure Touch ID really is until the products are in hand and tested. But I'm gonna bet there's going to be some really good talks on fingerprint authentication at the next few HackerCons.
And with all of the coming hacker fingerprint tools, which we can only expect, it might actually change the landscape in the validity of fingerprints in court.
Yeah.
That could be interesting. Now, the latest from the NSA. It turns out the NSA shares signals intelligence with the Israeli ISNU.
What?
The latest Snowden leak published by The Guardian outlines a memorandum of understanding between the NSA and Israeli intelligence agencies for the sharing of signals intelligence, including that of U.S. persons. Now, from the memorandum, raw SIGINT, or signals intelligence, includes, but is not limited to, unevaluated and unminimized transcripts, GIFs, facsimiles, text, voice, digital networks, intelligence, metadata, and content, and that the NSA routinely sends ISNU, the Israeli SIGINT National Unit, minimized and unminimized raw collection. Now, the agreement isn't legally enforceable, and the Israelis can pretty much do whatever they want with the data, including sharing it with others, under the condition that U.S. persons are not identified. Furthermore, the communications that are either from or to officials of the U.S. government are to be destroyed upon recognition. And in this case, U.S. government officials are defined as, you know, officials from the executive branch, House of Representatives, states, Senate, and court. That's it. Now, Israel is not part of the Five Eyes, the tight-knit group between the U.S., Britain, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand. However, Israel has had a long-standing relationship with United States intelligence agencies. It hasn't always been the most favorable. In one recent top-secret 2013 intelligence report that was leaked, identified Israel as being, as well as Iran and China, as having targeted the U.S. with cyber attacks. The NSA declined to answer the Guardian's questions on whether the FISA court's, you know, permission was actually required for sharing such information. However, the NSA did make a statement to the effect of, "We're not going to comment on any specific information sharing arrangements."
Go figure.
Yes. And that the NSA doesn't use these relationships to circumvent U.S. legal restrictions.
Right, of course not.
We can only hope.
Now, last week we asked you how you feel about Apple, a U.S. company that may be beholden to national security directives from U.S. agencies. How do you feel about them with your data, with your fingerprints? And our comment of the week comes from None of Your Business, YouTube. After my school forced us to change to biometric methods of paying for our school dinners, I've given up on caring about who has my fingerprint. They already have it, so what? If you really were that bothered by privacy, you really wouldn't be on Facebook. We have seen Apple iCloud and Keychain, and no one bats an eyelid. Yet once biometrics come in play, everyone expletives their pants. Now, Apple biodata probably isn't compatible with any other platforms, and once turned to data, is as secure as your password. Big deal.
I don't buy the last bit about it being as secure as your password,
Definitely not. When
it does come to biometrics, you're right, people do flip their expletives. this week, we'd like to know, has the NSA lost your trust? You know, can they get it back? And if so, how? How do you feel the NSA could be reformed?
Poor NSA.
How can we have a long, committed relationship with our government?
How can we talk about this? Remember, you can find all the ways to subscribe at threatwire.org and get involved in our Google Plus community for continued discussions on stories like these. From Cassie, a new application is now available for Android called Wicker. It allows users to send secure text SMS messages through high-level encryption standards. The co-founder, Nico Sells, tells CNET, Wicker has been approached by the FBI and asked for a backdoor. We said no. Now, a paid and a free version will both be available. We should also note here that Wicker is proprietary software, meaning that it can't be independently audited. To quote security expert Bruce Schneier, cryptography is hard to do right, and the only way to know if something was done right is to be able to examine it. Some open source alternatives would be TechSecure, ThoughtCrime, and SurePost.
Yeah, ThoughtCrime's what's up.
Yeah.
The FBI acknowledged to taking control of Freedom Hosting Servers, a provider for Tor's network, and it was discovered at several of Freedom Hosting's hosted sites were serving up an error message, including a hidden code that would use a security hole to identify Tor users.
Ooh, that's no
bummer.
Fun. And from Jeremy, Google may very well have access to everyone's Wi-Fi passwords. A backup tool found on Android mobile phones copies your Wi-Fi password to a Google server. Authentication of a new phone with your Google account will download passwords and login data, but this can be disabled, erasing all data on Google servers.
This has been the case for years, and I can't believe this is now just coming up.
But
convenience, it always wins.
Woo-hoo.
Lavabit is heading to court, but it seems like mum's the word. The case was immediately placed under seal in the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals. The encrypted email service was allegedly used by Edward Snowden in Russia, and it voluntarily shut down service after a long secret legal battle. Now, Lavabit shut down with a statement, "I have been forced to make a difficult decision to become complicit in crimes against American people or walk away from nearly 10 years of hard work by shutting down Lavabit." The site's owner will make an opening brief by October 3rd, though it will probably also be under seal. The Lavabit site currently hosts a statement ending with a bold quote, "This experience has taught me one very important lesson. Without congressional act or a judicial precedent, I would strongly recommend anyone against trusting their private data to companies with physical ties to the United States."
Ouch. And with that,
I'm Darren Kitchen.
I'm Shannon Morse.
We'll see you on the internet.
Bye! Drink NSA!
What? Oh, man.